Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Wednesday, April 28th of our class, Math 208, Elementary Statistics at Delta College. This is our last class session. And remember, our class sessions this week have been strictly devoted to reviewing questions that you want to ask. You have exam 3 in your hands right now, and that's due in our assignments folder on our website by 11:59 on Friday, April 30. So we're strictly here today to answer your questions. You can come and go and stay as long as you like today, but send me the questions in chat or otherwise and see if we can knock some stuff out to help you finish off your work. I'm just working here at my desk and organizing papers, so I'll let you bring questions anytime you'd like. Let me look at a specific example. People are asking 11:07, goodness of fit. Okay, we can do that example very quickly. And very efficiently on the calculator. So that's a really good example. Let me pull this up on the screen, and then we'll write down the key facts on our paper where we're going to execute this problem in the calculator for you on the screen calculator. So first, I get my calculator loaded up right here. Goodness of fit test. Got it. Okay, so now I want to ask you a question, and you can respond again in the chat. Goodness of fit test is definitely a good example we should do. Example 11.7 in chapter 11 is not a goodness of fit test. It was a test of independence. If you're looking for a goodness of fit test, then you want to do an example like 11.3 or 11.4. And I don't have any problem doing those instead. I would start with 11.3. So before I go running off into 11.7, which is not a goodness of fit test, do you want to see a goodness of fit test or do you want to see section 11.7? You can just comment in the chat. Right. Okay, good. So let's do that. Let's warm up on example 11.3. It's a very good example. It does relate to the first question on the exam. This is going to be a small problem, not a fancy large problem. And so if you want to do another one out of the homework or something, that's fine, but this will quickly illustrate what we're supposed to do. Okay, so I'm going to bring up example 11.3 on your screen. It's right here. Good, good. So this is example, there's a blank page in your book. It just depends on how the book was formatted and they didn't need to leave a blank page there. But then here's the beginning of example 11.3. So let me share that on the screen. Got it. So here's a study that indicates the number of televisions that American families have in their houses has a certain distribution. And that is 10% of the families have no television, 16% have one television, 55% have two televisions, etc. Now, these first table here, that's what you expect. Someone has run this study and told you that this is the fact. Now you want to know if the fact checks out against a sample you take, maybe in your hometown, maybe amongst your friends, or in a certain city. So the second table says, here's a random sample of 600 families in the far western United States. And there, 600 families, they found 66 with no televisions, 119 with one television, 340 with two televisions, etc. So the question is, how does this match up with the previous study? Is this in line with the previous study? Does it maybe contradict the previous study? Does it wildly contradict the previous study? So we need to do a goodness of fit test. Goodness of fit says, does this thing that you observed match what you were told or expected? That's called goodness of fit. It's a chi-squared test. So let me write this information on the paper, then I'll switch the paper, then I'll switch the calculator. So we have number of televisions. And you have the results of a survey you've taken. So zero televisions, 1, 2, 3, 4, and oh, 4 or more. Okay, got it. And in this survey of 600 families, you have 66 with no televisions, 119 with one television, 340 with two televisions, 60 with three televisions, 15 families with 4 or more. And then you got to be careful about this. What did they tell you was the truth? What did they tell you was the fact? They did a different study, maybe larger study, where they gave you expected percentages. And I write these down. 10%, 16%. I'm going to add the percent sign to emphasize that these are percentages. 55%, 11%, and 8%. But that's not a survey of 600 people. That could have been a survey of 6,000 people, could have been a survey of 60,000 people. What we want to do is say, if these percentages were true, then how many of 600 would we expect to have zero televisions? 10% of 600. 10% of 600 is 60. So the number out of 600 that we expected was 60 out of 600. That's 10%. And then we fill in the rest of the numbers the same way. 16% of 600, that is 600 times 0.16. So you can fill these in. 50% of 600 is 300. So 55% is 330. 11% would be 66. And 8% of 600, that's 600 times 0.08, would be 48. These are not percentages, these are numbers of people surveyed. And if you add these up, you're supposed to get 600. So 6, 12, 0, carry the 2, 8, 17, 20, 30. 0, carry the 3. See here, I made 600 results expected. Now let's compare them to the other table. Oh, so excuse me, I'm going to go to the paper explicitly if you haven't already gone to the paper. Good. So here's a percentage from a large survey somewhere else. Out of 600 people I asked, I got this result. But from this survey, I would have expected 60, not 66, 96, not 119, 330, not 340. That's clearly different. But is it significantly different? That's the question. Is this significantly different? So different that I question this blue survey. I say, well, that can't be true. Or I don't believe that anymore. So this is called, I move my paper up now before we get to our calculator. This is called a goodness of fit test. Does what I observed fit what I expected? It is a chi-squared distribution test. And for the chi-squared test, we have, like the t-test, a number of degrees of freedom. And the degrees of freedom is one less than the categories you have here. So here are the degrees of freedom. We have five categories. So there'll be 4 degrees of freedom. And we want to calculate our test statistic. That is chi squared. And in math symbols, that test statistic is the observed values minus the expected values divided by the expected values. Each one, there are 5 different ones, and then add up all those differences, squaring the difference between the observed and expected values. Now I'm going to do that on the calculator, but it literally means I'm supposed to take 66 minus 60, square it. Now that would be 6 squared, 36, and then 36 divided by 60, that would be the first thing that I'm adding. So since this is so small, I could literally write that out. 66 minus 60 squared over 60 plus, I won't write them all out. 119 minus 96 squared divided by 96. All the way down to the last one, which would be 15 minus 48 squared divided by 48. 15 minus 48 is not a tiny number. Now, instead of doing this by hand, which would only be 5 things, it's not so bad, I'm going to put this into the calculator. I'm going to call this list 1. I'm going to call this list 2. And then I'll be able to write this list 1 minus list 2, square it, and divide by list 2. So let's go to the calculator now. I am going to hang on a second. It's got some other thing going on here too. I have to get something else here. Excuse me, apologize. Okay, sorry. I'm on my calculator and I'm about to share my calculator with you. I'm sorry, I'm trying to get things organized here. Got that. Let's move this over to there. Excuse me. Now I can share calculator. Okay, good. Here we are in calculator and we say stat and we're going to edit. And we're going to edit our list, and they're empty right now, so that's great. So let's say 66, 119, 340, 60, 15. Those are the observed values from my survey. But according to the other survey I was given, I should have seen 60 televisions like that, or 60 families like that, 96, 330, 66, 48. Okay, good. Now let's go over here to list three and take list one minus list two, square it, and then divide by list two. So, parentheses, list one minus list two squared divided by list two. Now, the reason to demonstrate this is because I could do this if there's five elements, or I could do it if there's 50 elements, or 60, or 20. I mean, so this procedure is going to work in any case like this. Here's the distribution. And on my paper, if I thought about 66 minus 60, which is 6, squared is 36, 36 divided by 60 is 0.6. These numbers are legitimate. Now, what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to add them together. That's my test statistic. But I'm going to let the calculator add them together. Remember the feature called sum, sum L3. So I'm going to get out of the table. I'm going to sum up the elements in L3. Quit. And that was under list, math, number five, sum L3. And that comes out to be, ta-da, 29.6464. And I'm going to write that on our paper. But I will demonstrate. On the calculator. So the Z score is 29.6464. Now remember chi-squared distribution, and we'll draw it for you on the calculator, but I'll sketch it on the paper. Chi-squared distribution is something that's coming out here heavily loaded towards front, slowly tailing off. So wherever 29.6464 is, and remember this is a different chi-squared distribution, this chi-squared distribution 4 degrees of freedom. And in a chi-squared distribution, and you can look this up in your book, I think isn't the mean equal to the number of degrees of freedom. And just to remind you of that, that is when they introduced it on page, 622 in my book, but section 11.1 of this chapter. So the mean of this is about 4. The mean of this is 4. So 4 must be right here. So 29.6464, that's going to be like way, way out here. So the area left under here, that's the p-value. The area to the right. So what I'm thinking is I'm pretty sure this p-value, now remember, you have to check what the level of significance was in this problem. Actually, they changed it up on you. Sometimes it's 0.05, 5%. Here they said level of significance is 0.1. 1%. So they want to be very sure that they test these. Are they the same or different? So the hypothesis that we're using, the null hypothesis, is the distributions are the same. The alternative hypothesis, the distributions are different, And I need to know what area is under here. I'm going to ask my calculator. But it has to be less than 1%, less than 0.01, if I'm going to reject. So let's do this two ways in the calculator. I'm going to switch back to the calculator now. Share screen, calculator. I can literally go and calculate the distribution, chi-squared, cumulative distribution function. Sorry. It's right there, number 8. And the lower bound is the 29.6464. Sorry, 29.6464. I can't type too fast on the keyboard. Upper bound, infinity, 1 times 10 to the 99th power. Degrees of freedom, 4. And then this will tell me how much area is under there. And it is a tiny amount of area. So this p-value is 5.776 times 10 to the minus 6. That is 0.00005776. You move the decimal place 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 places to the right. That's what 10 to the minus 6 means. That is clearly less than 0.01. So we are going to reject H naught. And I'm going to say this in English and write this in English just so you're sure how to write this. But are these distributions the same that I have on my paper? I have evidence, pretty strong evidence, that these distributions are not the same. Some of them are similar, 340, 330. Oh, that's pretty close. But I think that 1548 sunk this whole ship. I mean, that's very different. 15 out of 600 is not 8%. Okay, so now we reject H naught, and I'm going to state the result in an English sentence. And the English sentence is not going to be, I reject H naught. Now make it about this problem, right? You got to make the English sentence about this problem, and they demonstrate this in the book. So my conclusion is, there is sufficient evidence and doesn't hurt to say at the 1% or 0.01 level of significance. It never hurts to mention the level of significance in your conclusion, because then everybody's clear on what that is. There is sufficient evidence at the 1% level of significance that these two distributions are not the same. Or you could say it like this, that the distribution of televisions among families in the Western United States. Did they say far Western United States? We want to be very clear on that. Far Western United States. I wonder exactly which ones they want. I suppose they're thinking the West Coast. Far Western United States. Is different. Than. The study that we were given suggests. first you say, well, that's a pain to write all that out. On the other hand, if you write this out in a sentence and it doesn't take that long, then everyone who's reading your work is very clear on what you intended to say and what you mean. Okay, good. So this is a quick example of a goodness of fit test. Do you want to see, I think it'd be fair to say, you want to see this curve on your calculator screen? No problem. It's not going to be very exciting because you're not even going to see this area under here, but we can put it on the calculator screen. So I'm taking back to the calculator, and let's say I go to my Y equals menu. Must have been doing some linear regression. And go to the Y equals menu, turn off that plot so it doesn't interfere. So if you get an error, sometimes you have another statistics plot turned on when you're trying to draw a function. Now let's go to the distributions. Let's go to the chi-squared PDF, the probability distribution function, and use the value X and use the degrees of freedom 4, right? Now put that in there. And now we got to pick a window that's going to go out to 29 or 30. Let's go out to 40 just to be solid. And I'm going to say window from 0 to 40. And I'll mark the x scale in fours. You don't often count by fours, but remember the mean of this is 4. So maybe you'd like to see that. The y is not going to be nearly minus 1 to 15. I think I'm going to just do 0 to 1 first to see where it is. Count by 1/10. If this graph isn't good, we'll adjust it. You know, it's a decent graph, but it's not, it's even, I gave more room than I wanted to, right? 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4. I think 0.3 is way more than enough. 0.25 is plenty. Let's adjust our window so that the Y scale says, so the Y max is 0.25 and this is 0.05 for our scale markers. Now we graph again and we get something a little larger, but remember this is 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 24, 28. You see there's absolutely no area under here after 29.6464. Now I don't want to say no area, zero area, because there was 0.0000576. I mean, a tiny amount of area, but there's nothing here that I can even shade. So if I try to shade from 29.6464, sorry, 29, don't type so fast, David, 6464, all the way up to 40, I'm not going to get anything. Oh, actually, it gave me the 5.7 times 10 to minus 6. Now, it keeps going. That's true, but it can't show me anything. Interesting to let the calculator show you, too. So let's look under stat. Let's turn off this graph and have the calculator draw it to think what scale the calculator wanted. So I'll go distributions, draw, shade chi-squared what? From 29.6464 to infinity, 1 times 10 to the 99th, and 4 degrees of freedom. Let's see what the calculator shades. See, the calculator's drawing is not different than ours. I mean, it might even be exactly the same scales. And there's nothing that it can shade to show you what's happening. Okay, back to paper. Now that was a short goodness of fit test. I mean short because the tables were not very long. But it does illustrate how you do it. And no, you do not have to calculate these differences squared divided by expected values yourself. I don't need you to calculate that on the paper. You can do that in a table in your calculator. You can also do it in the calculator test menu. Let me demonstrate that. So if I go to stats, tests, I can perform near the bottom a chi-squared test, goodness of fit. Now remember, there's a chi-squared test and a chi-squared goodness of fit test. We're doing goodness of fit. The chi-squared test would be for other things like test of independence. That's later in this chapter. So since I've entered this data already in the calculator, I'm ready to do the goodness of fit test. Because where did you put the observed things? L1. Where did you put the expected things? L2. We already did that. Degrees of freedom is 4, not 1. So the calculator didn't pick that up. Now let's calculate. See, here's the 29.6464. That's our test statistic. Here's the 5 times 10 to the minus 6, 5.776 times 10 to the minus 6. And if we want to run that again, and again have the calculator draw, again, we're not going to see anything serious here. But let's let the calculator draw. See, it says P equals 0 because it doesn't even draw anything. And I don't know what scale it's using here. Can I trace this? I want to know what one of these scale markers is here on the x-axis. That's about 1. This is about 2. Okay. So 29 is way, way out here to the right, off screen. So again, there's no area. I mean, the graph looks pretty, but there's no area to shade, no appreciable area. Okay, that's a great question. And that's a great start. Remember, you know, state your conclusion. It's good to assemble all these numbers, but state your conclusion in plain English so that people can understand you. And even more importantly, so that, you know, you don't leave any doubt in their mind that you know what you did, that you know what this result is. Okay. Very good. So, you can have another example. If you like, you pick up another example or just another topic, that's fine, either way. Excuse me. I guess people also, people have televisions in their houses. I mean, it's not the case that nobody has televisions anymore. In fact, they have giant ones. But I'm also knowing that we certainly don't use televisions the same way, right? You have a television in your house, but you don't have any cable TV and you don't have any antenna on your roof. You're just running stuff off the internet, which is perfectly fine, you know. I don't know what people use, Sling, Chromecast, Apple TV, Roku. You certainly have something on your wall or on your table called a television. That doesn't mean you're watching, you know, broadcast television like your parents did or my parents did. Let me look at the problem you're suggesting. Another suggestion in the chat for anyone who's watching this recording later. Because if you watch this recording later, you do not see the chat. Okay. 107. Excuse me, let me get my glasses. Is there a difference between the distribution of community college students and distribution of university students in what technology they use on their homework? I'm reading it. I'll pull it up for you in a second. Of some randomly selected college students. Okay, I will. This is not a bad problem, but I want to point out, and I'm going to double check this. This is from a section we did not do in the book. So this is not something you would see on your homework. I'll tell you what it is, but I don't want you to do it because this is not what we discussed in class. Let me show you in the book exactly what problem someone was referring to. So let me pull up the book. Book, where's the book? So here we go. And I'm going to share a book with you. Got it. Go. And now, first of all, I'll look at the problem. And I'll try to make this larger for you. The problem that was asked doesn't sound very strange. Problem 107. Is there a difference between distribution of community college students and distribution of university students in what technology they use on their homework? Some use the computer, some use the calculator. Some use the table from the textbook. So here, they are not asking you if the distributions fit. They're asking you specifically if there's a difference between two distributions. You're comparing distributions. This is section 11.5. So let me go backwards to the beginning of this chapter review here. We specifically did in this chapter just sections 11.1, 11.2, and 11.3. 11.5 is something different called a comparison of the chi-square tests. So this is a goodness of fit test to determine if data fits a particular distribution, and the test of independence makes use of a contingency table to determine the independence of the two factors. This is determining if two populations came from the same distribution, even if the distribution is not known. This is not a goodness of fit test, and this is not a test of independence. We were strictly doing these two problems. So I don't ordinarily pass on questions, but I don't want you to do that question because that's not what you're going to use on the exam. There are no questions using that on the exam. Sometimes in the book, she put questions in different sections that referred to previous sections. So I don't, it's not wrong to find problems in other sections. Similarly, 11.4 we did not do. That's called the test for homogeneity. But that problem 107 is not what we were doing here. If you want to try another problem, test of independence 11.3, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm trying to remember because I don't have my whole exam on the tip of my tongue, but I'm expecting that there had to be a problem like that. I have to go and pull up the exam so I know exactly what I'm talking about. Oh, yes. Yeah, so we did use test of independence on the exam. In fact, the problem even said conduct a test of independence. That would be section 11.3. Let me look at that example. Your question is, what about example 11.5 on 634? I'll tell you what that example is, and I don't mind reading it with you, but that is only trying to tell you how to fill in an expected table. Let me see if I can find something better than that. So you're looking for a problem about test of independence, and we can find one. But example 11.5 in the book was just showing you how to fill in the expected table. So I'm looking among the exercises, among 11.3. Here, let's do 86 and 11.3. That would be better. No, not a problem. Okay, so let's do this. Let's do exercise 86 in section 11.3. I'll write this down on the paper. Then we have to execute this in the calculator. this is a good example, a test of independence. So I will bring it up on the screen, and I'll write it on the paper, then we'll jog over the calculator. Here's a very straightforward question. A recent debate about where in the United States skiers believe the skiing is best prompted the following survey. Test to see if this best ski area is independent of the level of skier. Tahoe, never been there. Utah, never been there. I think I once skied in Colorado. That would be like very, very long time ago. Now, but here's the question when you look at that table. Do beginners prefer Tahoe? Do intermediate skiers prefer Colorado? Do advanced skiers prefer Utah? You know, just looking at the numbers in the table, maybe you could say those things, but maybe the way that those numbers fall out in that table is just a lot of random chance. Maybe beginners don't know the difference between Tahoe, Utah, or Colorado, or don't prefer them. How will you know? How will you know? This is called test of independence. Is the type of skier independent of which ski resort they prefer? Or is the ski resort they prefer independent of the type of skier? You know, maybe, oh, fancy skiers, they got to go to Utah, which, as I understand, would have like very sharp and steep hills. Colorado is kind of very much more rolling hills, long runs, but Utah might be, oh, some technically difficult hills. I don't know anything about Lake Tahoe. So now we're going to write this down on the paper. And we have the ski area in the columns. And then we have, I'm sorry, in these three rows, Tahoe, Utah, Colorado. There's not going to be much writing here. I'm just going to do that table. And then we have the level of skiers here in three columns. Beginner, intermediate, advanced. I'm somewhere between beginner and intermediate, and I don't even like to ski. I'd rather snowboard. I think skiing is dangerous. You got two different things on your feet. One leg's gonna go one direction, the other leg's going the other direction. At least on a snowboard, both of your legs are stuck together. They're not gonna separate. So let's fill these in. Beginners. There were 40 beginners surveyed. 20 of them preferred Tahoe, 10 preferred Utah, 10 preferred Colorado. Intermediate, 30, 30, 40, the 100 intermediate surveyed, 30, 30, 40 preferred Colorado. Advanced, how many do we got there? 150, 40 preferred Tahoe, 60 preferred Utah, 50 preferred Colorado. Now this table that I just drew here, this would be called observed. These are actual people that I surveyed, apparently. But what's missing in this table, what's really important, is this idea of how many were in each row and column. So watch this. Even if they do not have this in the problem, you always add one more column to add up the rows, which is 90, 100, and 100. And then you add one more row to add up each column, to add up the column totals. And now I'm back to my paper, so let me slide to my paper. We don't need the book anymore. So I wrote down all the information. I added up each row. Now I'm going to add up each column. 40, 100, and 150. I should check that I get the same number each time, right? 40 plus 100 plus 150 is 290. And here we add up the columns. The column here, we get 290. So that checks out. Make sure you added correctly. Now, how do I get what I expected? Because we're going to do the same observed minus expected squared divided by expected. And I'm going to write the table again, but write the table in an abbreviated way so I don't use so many letters. Let's say Tahoe, Utah, Colorado, TUC. Let's say beginner, intermediate, advanced. And this is what that example 11.5 was doing for you. And that's what I'm going to demonstrate right now. But this is built into your calculator. They were trying to explain it in section 11.5. Do you see 90 out of 290 preferred Lake Tahoe? And 40 out of 290 were beginners. So I want to know 90 out of 290, what percentage is that? And then what percentage of these 40 people should this be? So let me illustrate. This is my expected table. So I might bring out my hand calculator here for a second. Let's do 90 divided by 290 on the calculator. That's 31%. So now let's talk about these 40 beginners. If 31% of people in general prefer Tahoe, then maybe 31% of the beginners should prefer Tahoe. That would be what? If it didn't matter whether you were a beginner, intermediate, or advanced, if the three categories, beginner, intermediate, advanced, were independent of Tahoe, Utah, or Colorado. So in example 7, example 11.5 that you originally asked about, that's exactly what they did. They took the 40 times 90 over 290. To get the amount of beginners they expected to prefer Tahoe. And that is, you see on the screen here, 12.4. Let's go one step further. Oh, 12.41. The calculator is going to carry all these numbers for me, so I'm not going to go to many digits. What about the 100 intermediates? If 90 out of 290 prefer Tahoe, what's 100 times 90 divided by 290? That's 31.03. Last time, 150 times 290 over 90. I'll calculate that too, and then I'll show you why. 150 times 90 divided by 290. 46.55. Now let me show you why I did those. I still want to have the same number of total people that prefer Tahoe. I want to use the same total proportions I have. So if you add 1241, 3103, 4655, what should you be getting here? 43, 47, what's 43 and 46? 89, 47 plus 55, that's about 90. Now, if I did that, you know, totally legally, what do we got here? 9, stop. 9, stop. And then 77, 87, 89. Because I rounded off, it didn't come out to be 90 exactly. It came out to be 89.99. But see, here's the question. Maybe this shows me that beginners really do prefer Tahoe. Because there's 20 in my survey, but I expected 12.4. The intermediates are similar, aren't they? Even the advanced, they're kind of similar, but a little bit off. So I will not do this by hand very often, but I'll fill in these values in the last two rows. And I showed you a trick like this in class. I take the 40, 100, and 150, and I put them in braces on the calculator. Let me show you how to do that on the screen calculator, just so you're sure you can see it. Let's quit that screen. Let's clear this screen. I could take the 40, 100, comma. I need braces, excuse me. Oh, I have to press it on the calculator screen. Excuse me, braces, 40, 100, 150, braces, and multiply that by the next row, which was 100 out of 290. And see, that gives me just these numbers right away that I'll fill in on my paper. 1379, 3448, arrowing over, 5172. Some differences from the second row. Let's do the third row. I don't have to change the 40, 100, 150. I don't even have to change the 100, it's the same ratio. I could repeat what I just did, but I already have it on the screen. 13.79, 34.48, 51.72. And notice if I add each of these row and column, I'm supposed to get the same numbers I did on the side. Right here, I get 9 carry the 1, 5, 12, 9 carry the 1. 9, 3. I don't get 40 exactly, I get 39.99. And then likewise here, I get 9 carry the 1, 9 carry the 1, no carry, 9 and 9. I get 99.99 because I rounded off. Adding here, I get 9, no carry, 12, 9, carry the 1, 7, 8, 9, and then no carry, 14. 149. It's not exactly the same as here, but it tells me that I did this calculation right. And the row totals right here are going to be 9, carry the 1, 8, 12, 9, carry the 1, 52, 86, 99. Okay, so everybody just a little bit off right there. This is 9, carry the 1, 8, 9, carry the 1. 2, 6, 9, carry the 1. And I get 6, 9, 10, 1. I get, 9, no carry, so I just get 99.99 there. Okay, so here I'm getting my 289.97, but that's not a big error. So now I'm gonna do my, let's go back to the paper, and the calculator is gonna do this for me. I'm gonna do the observed minus the expected, the black table, the black nine numbers minus the blue nine numbers squared divided by the expected value. But I'm going to do it for the whole table. And last time I just did it for two columns. Now this is built into the calculator under chi-squared test. So let's go execute chi-squared test on the calculator. And you had to do that in a particular way. So that's why I'm demonstrating it. So I got my calculator going right here. I have to put this table of black numbers into the calculator. Do you remember how we did that? The book demonstrates in matrix. So I am editing a table. Matrix is a fancy math word for table. This table has three rows and three columns. The three rows are Tahoe, Utah, Colorado. The three columns are beginner, intermediate, advanced. Now I put in the numbers, 20. Somehow my zero doesn't always register. 20, excuse me, 30, 40. The calculator does the totaling on the sides and the bottom. I don't need to put in the totals. We're doing a good job here. 60, last row, 10. 10, not 1, 40, and 50. Now that I have this table in the calculator, I can go to the statistics tests. Just quit, statistics, test. And last time it was the goodness of fit test. This is just a straight chi-squared test. And let me write down the hypothesis for you. This is a two-tailed test. Either these categories are independent, that's the default, or these categories are dependent. Whether or not you prefer one of these ski resorts depends on whether you're a beginner, intermediate, or advanced. So it's the chi-squared test. The degrees of freedom is the number of rows minus one times the number of columns minus one. So in this problem, the degrees of freedom is 4. And the test statistic, I'll go to my paper while I'm writing these down, then we'll switch back to the calculator. The test statistic, or the test score, is to add up the differences squared divided by the expected values for that whole nine numbers. That's why I don't want to do this by hand. I'm going to let the calculator do it. Now let's go to the calculator. I'll show you how the calculator does it. Share screen, calculator. It's called the chi-squared test. Excuse me, I have to hit enter. And the calculator asks me for a table, for a matrix. The calculator said, where did you put your table? Where did you put your matrix? and the observed values were in A. And then the calculator says, where do you want me to put the expected values? And B is fine. So now we're going to go down and calculate. So the expected values that I have in blue, I should see them in the calculator when I do this calculation. Here's my calculation. The test says the chi-squared score is 10.5259. It says the p-value, the shaded area, is equal to 0.03. That's not tiny. I mean, that's 3%, you know, 244. But now I got to check my level of significance. Now remember, if they don't give you a level of significance, you use the default level, which is 5%. So this is less than 5%. So we reject H naught. Now let's write it in English. Then I'll go and shade it for you on the calculator screen. We're going to reject H naught. That means the categories are not independent. We're thinking we have evidence that what kind of skier you are is related or depends on which resort you prefer, or the resort you prefer depends on the kind of skier you are. So let's say that in English very carefully. There is sufficient evidence. You could say sufficient or significant. There's sufficient evidence. Put in the level of significance at the 0.05 or 5%, either way, level of significance. That the ski resort you prefer is dependent on the type of skier you are. Well, let's just say on the type of skier level you are. Not saying that super precise, but I said that pretty good. This is a good English statement of the result. Don't just say there is sufficient evidence to reject H-naught. I mean, tell me what it means to reject H-naught. That's what she's trying to coach you to do in the book. We could calculate these numbers ourselves, but I want you to see that these numbers are in the calculator in matrix B. So if I go to matrix B, second function matrix B, B, look at matrix B. Do you see those numbers? 1241, 1379, 1379, 3103, 3448. The same numbers I had in blue, just calculator used all the decimal places. How about calculator drawing this for me? Let's try that. Stat, test. Where's my chi-squared test? Down here. Matrix A, matrix B. But this time I want the calculator to draw it for me. Yeah. So now this time I actually get to see a shaded area, which is nice. I don't like it when the p-value is so tiny that there's no doubt. Here there's a little bit of doubt. There's a 3% probability that these results could have been had randomly. And that's not very much still. That's still not very much. So I am still willing to believe. It's less than the 5% level of significance. I am willing to believe now that the ski resort you prefer does depend on the type of skier you are. Now, let's think about that statement for just a second. You would have said before I did this, you would have believed that, right? But now we have some kind of evidence. That's what the statistics is about. You know, actual evidence from a survey. Well, I have to believe their survey, of course. I have to believe their survey, but here's some real statistical evidence. Okay, that was a good problem. You don't have to write those tables out yourself. If you look at the homework problem I did write out the tables for you because so you could see it, but you don't have to write out the tables for yourself as long as you're stating all these things. What are your hypotheses? Let me go back to my paper. What are your hypotheses? What is your level of significance? Might as well say that. Although I said it right there. What is your test statistic? What is your test score? What is your p-value? Is the p-value less or more than the level of significance? Does that mean you reject H-naught or do not reject H-naught? And then lastly, say exactly what you mean in English. So that's a good demonstration of how to do a problem like that. And I think there wasn't, like I said, one of the problems on the test says very specifically, perform the test of independence. So here's, you know, kind of a good model for that. Okay. I'm not going to throw another question in here, like doing a whole question. I don't think that's going to happen. But is there any kind of brief question you want to throw out before we go? Remember, your test is due Friday night. You can still send me an email if you got stuck on something or something's just crazily not working. And if I can't answer the question, I'll be direct with you and say, I can't answer that question. But you still have access to me for these next 3 days, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Is there anything else I can do for you right here, live? Okay, that's okay, not a problem. Okay, well, then I'll get these scanned and posted. Let me number this one. I'll get the recording up for the people who watch the recording later. And after a little bit of rain this morning, it seems like a decent day. You go out and enjoy yourself. Just write this down for people who are watching later. I say up to submission of your test. I don't mean email me at 11:30 on Friday night. I might be up. I don't think I'll be able to help you very quickly. But you send me a question anytime, I'll tell you if I can or can't help you. Okay, you guys go hang out, have a good day, and I'll see you around. I'll communicate with you by email when everything's graded. But if you have any other question about anything else, even after class is over, you're always welcome to send me an email. You guys have a nice day.